folks, Dr. Will Wong here, and welcome to tonight's edition of The Essentials of Life and Wellness. As is usual, and I've been away from the mic for a while, we have a bunch of questions, so let's start on them straight away. The first one reads, "Hi, I have a question about systemic enzymes. I saw a video suggesting the reason that we heal worse as we age is because our bodies produce less of these enzymes. Thus, if we supplement with systemic enzyme products, will our bodies produce even less?" And he capitalized the "even less" of them, making us heal even slower. "Since we're getting them from an external source, does our body shut production down?" Those of you who've heard my lecture know the answer to this one, but Will, he's a newbie, so we'll be nice. And my answer is howdy. That might be an issue if the enzymes were produced by the endocrine system, but they're not. The enzymes are made by the exocrine system, as are tears, sweat, and saliva. If we take a shower, we don't make any less sweat. If we drink, we don't make any less saliva. If we wash our eyes in the morning, we do not stop making tears. In lectures, I've even had to remind doctors of the two different systems. So here's the information you need to have, and I gave him the address of my lecture, "Fighting the Things Most Likely to Kill Us. Be Well and God Bless, Dr. Wong." And then this same fellow came back and asked another question. "Dr. Wong, thanks. I was thinking about testosterone. If we take it from the outside, do we make less?" And my answer is howdy. Point one, that depends on your age and your level of production. If you're 45, 50 plus, your own production will be low and getting lower each year. And yes, testosterone being part of the endocrine system, if you put it in at higher than physiologic values, as the bodybuilders do, you will shut down your own production. But even with this, as we saw with Arnold, he still had three kids, you can kickstart that production back up by using human chorionic gonadotropin. When the T is put back at physiologic levels, the levels that are normally found in men, not the levels that are normal for your age, there is no shutdown. Point number two, if your own production is normal for your age, that is the road to decrepitude and death. Let's have an analogy. If the water tap in your sink is so clogged, it only drips, can you wash dishes well? It's still producing, isn't it? But is that production of any practical or physiologic use? Body chemistry has thresholds below which nothing happens and above which everything happens. That holds true for antibiotics, vitamins, minerals, enzymes, and hormones. So if your own T production is so low that it doesn't create that 20-year-old feel, what good is it? Be well and God bless, Dr. Wong. And the next question reads, "Dear Dr. Wong, thanks for all of your help. Very few doctors would take the time and care as you do. Is there any particular diet that needs to be done when fighting candida? And I understand that your thinking is that the cream of tartar, in a way, finally poisons the candida by bathing it in its own waste product. Is that correct? Others have said you can grow candida in this sort of tartaric acid. I might have the wrong name. So is your knowledge is that it will kill the candida, even the fungal form? I understand that it will take time. Is it likely that things will get worse before they get better, like a die-off, bloating? Sorry for the lengthy stuff. Thanks so much. And my answer is howdy. You won't find candida, or mold, living in a petri dish on top of tartaric acid. The late Dr. Tom Rivas was a doc who revived the use of cream of tartar against yeast and mold infections, and he used no diet except he asked his patients to avoid eating of wheat and wheat products, but even that was not a hard, fast rule. The candescence kills the yeast almost as fast as an nystatin drug will, with none of the liver toxicity had with the drug. Most cases of candida are gone or significantly improved in 3 months of 4 teaspoons of candescence a day. Afterwards, 1/2 to 1 teaspoon a day for maintenance should prevent its reoccurrence. Be well and God bless, Dr. Wong. And the next question reads, "Dear Dr. Wong, my mother has been prescribed Sirmion and Betacirc for pulsations in her ears by the doc. I kind of know what he's aiming at, but given the fact that these meds don't treat the disease, I want to ask you if you think that systemic enzymes would be efficient, and if yes, what dose? Is there anything you know that could remedy the situation? Thank you. And my answer is howdy. Nope. Systemic enzymes won't help for pulsation in the ears. That's due to blood flow and blood pressure. Seniors tend to have rigid blood vessels which don't dilate well. Now, don't be too sure that the medications don't ever really cure or fix anything. Some do. The ergot mushroom-derived drugs, such as aspirin, have been shown to build the brain cells, reduce blood pressure, increase blood flow generally, especially to the brain, and they extend lifespan. One ergot-derived drug, ergotamine, should be stayed away from because it causes fibrosis. Be well and God bless. Dr. Wong. I'll also remind you of the other drug that seems to do some miraculous stuff, and that is the heart and blood pressure drug called Coreg. Years ago, in the late 90s, early 2000s, that drug came out with a fanfare of publicity, and everyone was prescribing it, and everyone was feeling good from it, because it has very little, if any, side effects. It's one of the drugs, one of the BP meds that has the lowest side effect profile of any of the meds around. Only Diavan is better. And it turned out that Coreg was doing some pretty miraculous stuff in some patients, not all of them, but some. It was completely rebuilding their hearts, almost to new. Well, you can't have that in regular medicine because you're going to lose a patient. If they get better from your medication, they won't come back for more. You lose out on doing heart surgeries, you lose out on hospital time, you lose out on prescribing all sorts of meds. So, from being a highly vaulted treatment for irregular heartbeat and blood pressure, the Coreg has been almost completely forgotten because it does have the tendency to rebuild the heart and cost the medical industry money. The other drugs which do really well at improving circulation, increasing lifespan, building brain cells, are all of the drugs based from mushrooms. From gabapentin, which is a painkiller, to selegiline, which is prescribed for Parkinsonism. All of those ergot mushroom-based drugs will build brain tissue. They don't know how yet. They're keeping it very quiet. They don't want anyone to know because, again, tons of money, big money, is being made from patients getting dementia. By the way, of the readily available mushrooms that are available over the counter, look at the extracts of lion's mane. There are extracts that range from 8x or 10x all the way up to 50x. You know, take half a teaspoon of those powders once or twice a day. Take your B-complex vitamins. Take your medium-chain triglycerides. Take your B12 and your folic acid. And you will be feeding your brain. And it's very likely you will never get dementia. Or if you're in the early stages of it, you might even be able to reverse it. And if telling you that doesn't put me into the telescopic sights of the medical industry in the U.S., I don't know what will. And the next question reads, Dear Dr. Wong, so you're a fan of Voll testing. I've never done that before. I've seen some chiropractors in my area that do EVA testing. Would you recommend getting tested? Thank you for your time. And my answer is, howdy. Voll testing is the least invasive way to test for allergies, toxins, and imbalances. I highly recommend it. Be well and God bless, Dr. Wong. And the next question reads, howdy, Dr. Wong. We have spoken before. I'm the retired Brooklyn cop. I have a question. A pretty well-known biologist with a good info said the enzymes are not good because they may cause some bleeding while lysing the arteries. So he says to avoid the enzymes. I use your great time essence and love your take as a Brooklyn guy with smarts. He advocates aspirin, vitamin K, etc., the good stuff, it seems. And are the enzymes okay with aspirin if those benefits are true? And my answer is howdy. God save us from nutritional biochemists. Those guys think the body's a damn test tube. These are the same idiots who said the enzymes in acidophilus can't live in the same entity, ignoring the fact that the exact thing happens in the intestinal tract of every living animal. Even before the enzymes became popular in the U.S. post-1998, and I'll take credit for that, by the way, 160 million Europeans had been prescribed systemic enzymes by their doctors between 1959 to 1999. There should have been some finding in the medical literature, the clinical experience, records and research of the types of hemorrhage this guy's talking about. And certainly since the increase in popularity, the explosion of popularity of systemic enzymes in the U.S. market, with a market now comprising some 3.3 or so percent of the total sales in the nutritional industry, there would be some indication of the hemorrhage effect in arteries this fellow is speaking to, but none, nada, zilch, zero. What this fellow is ignorant of is the issue that was resolved in 1970s when the German docs asked why the enzymes only ate scar tissue and pro-inflammatory cytokines and didn't eat all the other proteins in the body. Turns out that orally administered proteolytic enzymes only, lice, only eat proteins that are tagged by the body as not belonging there, i.e. they're tagged as exogenous. Enzymes work on a lock-and-key mechanism. Thus, it turns out that the exogenous protein tag are the only proteins the orally administered enzymes allow themselves to eat. This discovery of protein tagging in the 1950s won a Nobel Prize in Medicine in 1999. And talk about bleeding. If he advocates taking aspirin, the morbidity and mortality report of the CDC tells us that every year, 18 to 22,000 Americans die from taking aspirin, not from abusing aspirin, but simply from taking it. The first year aspirin was advocated to prevent heart disease, folks were told to take one regular aspirin a day. That year, the M&R counted the dead from nonsteroidal anti-inflammatory drugs as skyrocketing from the usual 18 to 22,000 to 45 to 46,000. So the medical authorities, in their wisdom, told folks next year to only take half an aspirin. Yeah, that's it. Half an aspirin. That year, the death rate was in the mid 30,000s, but still not 18 to 22. So the year after, the folks were told from the powers on high to use one quarter of an aspirin, a baby aspirin, and that year the death rate returned to within 18 to 22,000. So that's how they came up with taking a baby aspirin a day. It wasn't a great feat of science. It's the fact that they killed tens of thousands of people who needn't have died by prescribing something that was more toxic to the body and killed the body faster than the heart disease they said they were trying to prevent. Aspirin kills via kidney damage, renal failure, liver damage, leading to liver failure, and hemorrhage of the intestines. As a personal example, from a motor vehicle accident which actually killed me in 1961, I DOA'd on the way to Kings County Hospital, I got weekly migraines as a kid. They'd last for most of a week. Took a load of Excedrin back then. Right now, if I take just one aspirin or naproxen a day for 3 days straight, I'm pooping out raw blood a few days later. So this fellow is warning of hemorrhage effects he thinks may be possible from taking the enzymes while advocating the use of something that does cause hemorrhage and kills 22,000 people a year. Is his head up his ass? Be well and God bless, Dr. Wong. And the next question reads, Dear Dr. Wong, I'm taking your zymesins and was wondering what you thought of Nattokinase. I was taking a Natto K supplement from, and he names the company, Is natto beneficial for lowering cholesterol and overall heart and blood vessel health? Thanks for all that you do, and I greatly enjoy your podcasts. And my answer is howdy. To answer your question fully, I will cut and paste my answer from the Zymescence Compared page of my store website. Be well and God bless, Dr. Wong. Point number two, Dr. Wong hates nattokinase. On the products that have nattokinase and tout how great nattokinase is, why does Zymescence not have nattokinase? In nature, nattokinase is always found with vitamin K1, and that prevents the blood from becoming overly thin when eating natto curd and taking the nattokinase enzyme. When the nattokinase is extracted from the natto curd, the vitamin K is left behind. So of all of the proteolytic enzymes, it is the one most likely to create a danger of overly thin blood and cause hemorrhage and bleeding issues. We've spoken to two docs, one of whom is a very famous alternative doc, who both got themselves and their patients in bleeding trouble by using what were modest levels of nattokinase. So again, this is why there is no nattokinase in our products. Now, I will comment. The question before was about the enzymes eating through arteries and causing bleeding. In this instance, with the nattokinase, it's not that the enzyme is eating through the arteries. The enzyme is making the blood too thin, just like taking too much of the drug Coumadin, or, as is happening with all of the new drugs, the Eliquis and all those other new generation of blood thinners that can't be controlled, that have huge class action lawsuits against them. If I told you the name of the famous doc who got in trouble by taking moderate amounts of nattokinase, you'd recognize him. He called and asked me what was wrong and what was happening after he and three of his patients got in bleeding trouble with the nattokinase. Now, for all the folks out there taking nattokinase and the nattokinase doesn't cause that effect, well, either they put the vitamin K1 back in the nattokinase or your nattokinase doesn't work. It's that simple. And on that note, to find out why some enzyme products work and some don't, type Zymescence Compared into your search engine, and you'll see my Zymescence Compared page, and you'll read why some systemic enzyme products that claim to be great guns, have great numbers on the label, don't do jack, and why only a handful of them actually do what they're supposed to do. And the next question reads, Dear Dr. Wong, hope this email finds you well and blessed with this beautiful holiday season. I recently started to read about collagen supplements as my hair has been thinning and now I have had shoulder surgery. I completely tore out my rotator cuff with a full tear of my supraspinatus, a 50% tear of my infraspinatus. You know, I'm not a fan of vegetarianism, but I've been one for so long. I started adding fish back a few years ago, and for the first time I was seriously considered slowly reintroducing meat back into my diet. I've had so many injuries and such a hard time sustaining muscle mass, especially at my age, now being in my late 50s. Vegetarianism may not have been a good choice, but we learn as we go through this life. So my question to you is, do you have a collagen supplement that you recommend, and what are your thoughts on collagen supplements? You've been such a tremendous help to me through the years. I love your supplements and have used them for quite some time. Your supplements have seen me through quite a few surgeries and are a great part of my health regimen. I have even ordered them for all of my children, and now they use them as well. Thank you for all that you do, and may the good Lord continue to bless you and your family. We're in some dark times, but I believe that God will see us through. And my answer is, howdy. Hope you and yours had a great Christmas. The 50s is when most vegetarians figure out they have to eat meat or die. Worldwide, the life expectancy for vegans and vegetarians is 55. If like cures like, what do you need to rebuild the red meat your muscles and internal organs are made of? My wife, Michelle, a few years ago, went and bought several of the best raw material collagen products available. These were the ones sold in the super expensive collagen finished products. Doing our own research, we found out that they work no better than Knox gelatin. We now have 55 We now have a few 55 and 25-gallon barrels of the stuff in storage I don't ever intend to use. But here's where we hit on the principle. Just taking collagen won't build collagen. Your body has signaled itself to catabolize muscle, and with it, the collagen was lost that connects the muscle to the skin. Simply eating more collagen won't flip the switch to build from catabolize. When you were young and growing collagen, fascia, soft tissue, soft connective tissue, rather, the collagen got built with your building of muscle. Therefore, you must strength train. No yoga, tai chi, or girly type training will do it. Heavy weight for your strength level, low sets, low reps, 2 to 3 times a week. Go find a gym and weight train. Go exercise and take 1 teaspoon of Knox gelatin 2 to 3 times a day in some water. Seeing a difference will take some months, but it will happen. Build muscle to build collagen. Be well and God bless. Dr. Wong. Now, the process is this, folks. As we age, we lose a lot of muscle. You know, your typical bald-headed, skinny-armed, cardboard tube-legged guy with a potbelly isn't your poster boy for testosterone dominance. He's got estrogen dominance, and your typical gal over, let's say, 35, 40, especially after 45 into 50, is estrogen dominant, even though her estrogen may be lower due to premenopause and menopause. Estrogen's all she's making. Estrogen causes catabolism. Estrogen causes the body to waste muscle away. When you think of estrogen, think of catabolism and muscle wasting. When the muscle goes away, so does the collagen, because the collagen is what holds muscle to skin. So if you don't want to look saggy baggy, like your skin is just a sack on top of your skeleton, just taking collagen supplements isn't going to help much. You need to rebuild the muscle, and then your body will demand that you rebuild the collagen to connect that muscle to your skin. Get it? But also, you need to get away from being estrogen dominant, because again, estrogen is the hormone of catabolism, and you need to go into anabolism. Oh, that's a dirty word. No, it isn't. Anabolism is building. So you need to get on either the pro-testosterone supplements. If you're over 50, 55 and those supplements don't work anymore, you need to get on the medical testosterone. You need to, whether you're doing the supplements or doing the medical testosterone, make sure that you're taking an aromatase inhibitor so that the testosterone does not turn into estrogen. We want in anti-aging medicine to build the testosterone levels back to what we had when we were 20, or as close to it as we can possibly get. That way, your exercise will be effective in building muscle. That way, your body will be stimulated to build collagen. That way, your body can look younger, be stronger, and that will increase your bone density. Because you can't increase bone density without building muscle because of Wolf's Law. Wolf's Law properly states, not the definition they're taught in med school. That definition has been considerably monkeyed with in order to make docs think that they can just prescribe bone-building drugs and have women overcome osteoporosis. Wolf's Law properly states that mineralization is laid into bones along axial lines of stress. So in other words, you've got to compress the bone, you've got to pull on the bone, you've got to yank on the bone, you've got to put pressure on that piezoelectric matrix that electrically draws minerals into the bone to rebuild the bone. And you can't do that without weight training. Some docs will tell you, oh, just go for a walk. Okay, that might work for your lower extremities. What about your spine and upper extremities? You're going to walk on your hands? That's kind of hard to do for a mile or two. Been advocating weight training for seniors since I was an undergrad, and way back then I was told, oh, but the doctors say that aerobic health is much more important. Turns out that all the aerobic exercisers are dying at the same rate and age that their couch potato cousins are, and those are medical statistics. I'm not making this stuff up. This wasn't the result of research. This is a medical finding. Meanwhile, the seniors who strength train, seriously strength train, not just mentally masturbated weightlifting, actually extend their lifespans, have greater joint mobility, greater body mobility, greater aptitude and abilities in their activities of daily living. Everything is improved through proper strength training. So what are you waiting for? I will leave you tonight without commenting on the steel, without commenting on the communism that is coming, without commenting on the dark days ahead. I will simply say this: God save America, and God bless Texas. Until next time, folks, God bless, be well, and I'll chat with you again. Bye-bye.
Thank you for joining Dr. Wong this evening for the Essentials of Life and Wellness. If you have any questions about this show, or if you want to ask Dr. Wong any health-related questions, you may email those questions to him directly at askdrwong@drwongsessentials.com. The products Dr. Wong recommends can be found online at drwongsessentials.com, or you can speak with a customer service representative at 866-268-3216. Dr. Wong also has an extensive natural health website written in Dr. Wong's unique and easy-to-understand style that discusses remedies for some of today's most debilitating and chronic conditions. Those are at drwong.us. Dr. Wong's lecture and podcast from 2007 through 2016 can be heard at drwongradio.com. His podcasts since 2016 and his lecture, Fighting the Things Most Likely to Kill Us, can be found on YouTube by searching for Dr. William Wong's Essentials of Life and Wellness. Until next time, we hope you have a safe and healthy week. Be well and God bless.